30 years ahead of our time now on BBC Two. Dallas and Dynasty are long forgotten, but Clinton and Monica Gate live on.
It is the year 2028. Over the past 30 years, there have been only two major advances in technology. One is the invention of the flying scooter, and the other is that the advent of digital television now means that no matter where you are on the planet, you can have immediate access to the Granada Men and Motors channel. In America in 2028, the people elect Governor Cameron Diaz of Alabama, the 42nd President of the United States. She gets in on a policy of starting a war with Holland. But her Oval Office has been sullied by the events in Washington of 30 years ago. Because in 1998, the post of president came close to being destroyed by the actions of one man and 11 or 12 women. This program is the definitive account of those events. We will examine the unbroadcast archives of that era, a time when Americans still spoke a language approximating to English.
It depends upon what the meaning of the word is.
We will also catch up with some of the key participants in that period, translating their recollections from New American or Nob Americano.
The Marquis was a Rockefeller knight.
My husband's impeachment was an abuse of justice, and the best way to defend justice is to lie like hell in court or in front of people.
To spin like a devil for the folks.
I maintain to this day that I did not have sexual relations inside Monica Lewinsky.
Funnel, Monica Lewinsky.
It was the biggest sexual trauma to badger America, and towards the end of the last century, it spattered the planet in a tidal wave of dirt. Early months of 1998. It's a time of great uplift and economic cockiness. The world is at peace listening to the music of McAlmont and Brian May. The only thing in people's minds are the recently published memoirs of Edward Heath. Islamic terrorism has been defeated and casualties are reasonable. And yet, 6 months later, all is completely miserable again. A succession of stock market crashes leaves the Japanese scuttled. Boris Yeltsin was clearly an idiot and was forced to surrender power to a nightclub bouncer. Delia Smith proved that no one knew how to chop up a carrot. Salman Rushdie was still being stalked. And the unionists refused to meet with Sinn Féin for more than 2 seconds. 1998 turned really terrible. The blame for this momentous upheaval is laid at the mouth of one woman, Monica Lewinsky. What was it about her that in the space of 12 months turned her into the most notorious wide person the world has ever seen? Tonight, 30 years on, speaking in Nob Americano, she explains.
Well, all cats slam it back a rumpy.
Everyone boils it down to sex, but it was about love. I loved him.
I mailed a guy, me met him.
I gave him my heart and called him all sorts of affectionate names, like you there and Mr. Dirty Legs.
Mighty spunky thighs.
Whatever. Today, 30 years on, every schoolchild knows the events that led up to the crisis, and we're no longer shocked by their graphic detail.
Yes, that's 1996. And during this, he fondled her bare breasts and genitalia with his hands and mouth. And so it's become known and celebrated in America as Pudenda Day. Actually, they pronounce it Pudenda, 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 whatever.
We've all been taught how Bill Clinton, when he was governor of Arkansas, allegedly ushered a woman by the name of Paula Jones into his hotel room, shook his chapiter and shouted, "Here come the buffalo." During the harassment trial, the president denied having an affair with Monica Lewinsky. One man was determined to prove the president was lying. That man was Kenneth Starr.
Hello.
Today, Starr owns a 15,000-acre site in Las Vegas, which he's turned into the world's first Methodist casino where gambling is forbidden. To make gambling more difficult, he hasn't put up any buildings. By patrolling the area in his hover scooter, he stops anyone he thinks might be about to gamble. 30 years ago, Starr tried to stop Clinton, whom he thought might be about to commit a crime.
Clint Almighty was pushing a brick up the judges.
Bill Clinton was trying to obstruct justice. When someone tries to obstruct justice, it's perfectly valid to stitch them up. That's what it says in my Bible.
That's all in my Godmobile.
At first, Starr's inquiry drew a blank. Desperately, he aired this footage as conclusive proof that Clinton and Lewinsky were involved in a relationship. But the president's defenders were quick to argue the clip was being clumsily shown out of context. The president, they said, hugged lots of people. Did that mean he had a relationship with every one of them? However, events later proved that actually it did.
Well, I had an affair with Clinton for 12 years.
Clinton had indeed had an affair with everyone he had hugged on camera.
We had an affair with the president for 12 months.
He said if we kept quiet, he'd give us a good job in the Pentagon.
As rumors of the scandal broke, Clinton was forced to lie in public. Recent evidence suggests that not only was he having an affair with Lewinsky at the time, but that she was actually carrying on the affair under him during this televised denial.
But I want to say one thing to the American people. I want you to listen to me. I'm going to say this again. I did not have sexual relations with that woman.
Miss Lewinsky.
I never told anybody to
lie.
Not a single time.
Never.
These allegations are
false.
And I need to go back to work
for the American people. Thank you.
The approach worked. Opinion poll after poll showed the president's popularity ratings at an all-time high.
Evaporated rumpy pictures.
I did not have sexual relations with Monica Lewinsky.
No, you bet your mouth.
However, I am prepared to say I did have homosexual relations with her.
With heavy dude shunting with the dame.
Thank you, Bridget.
Gordon, back to you.
Thanks, Bridget.
In 1998, the world's media dropped everything and rushed over to America to stare at the facts in the face. Gordon Brewer was Britain's fact-finder general.
Although it's quite interesting what happened. There are so many camera crews here, there's such as the sense of high drama, that we actually collectively managed to blow all the power circuits.
If you think of it, you know, a long working day with 8 satellite feeds in one's ear. Of course, you know, we were pioneers in the technology then. We didn't know that all these electrical pulses coming into one's head could fuse the brain in places and damage one's mental coordination. So although I was wearing a tie, I was almost a vegetable.
It turns out he has a press conference.
Sorry to interrupt you, Bridget.
In the middle of the week.
Just explain to us what a prayer breakfast is.
Bridget, I think you'll need to get yourself a log cabin built there, as you never seem to get away from the place.
Interesting point is it did affect my hands. I found them terribly difficult to control. I couldn't do simple things like, picking up a pile of papers.
Now, a quick look at tomorrow's papers, and it's Bill Clinton. You won't be surprised at who's leading many of them. The Times there, Republicans...
But as Brewer visibly deteriorated for our benefit, he was uncovering a truth that was soon to set the whole world spinning on its Antarctica.
We were all in the Cabinet office and there was something going on, I can't remember now. But Tony turned around and said, Bill's in trouble. I've got to go out and help him.
On January 24th, 1998, as the storm slush gathered round the president, Prime Minister Tony Blair flew out to offer Clinton his support.
Tony said, I'll have to go out and see him. And if he's been naughty, which I think he has, Britain will have to help him, we'll have to help him. I mean, but on the condition that he tells me what actually happened in that Oval Room.
So we gathered for the meeting. It was about trees or finance or something. And Tony said, Mr. President, before we start, you have the complete backing of the British government, provided that we go into that room next door and man to man, you tell me what happened between you and Monica Lewinsky.
And the president sort of looked at him and gave a smile. He seemed to think for quite a while and then he said, OK, Tony, I'll tell you the whole story.
And
shortly afterwards, Tony ran out and he was sick.
Tony Blair was violently sick 3 times that day, and once again in the evening over his trade secretary. It was the start of a compulsive behaviour that was to dominate his time in office.
In the next 12 months, the Prime Minister succeeded 4 or 5 times getting a meeting with the President. And Tony would come running out of the room sick, all running all down his chin and his face looking like a burst peacock.
Oh, he used to bouk like a whale. And his raspy chander in front of the press, which was very upsetting when we were trying to get through with some welfare initiative. Of course, life goes on, doesn't it?
Well, my dad thought it was terrible.
But by now, the costs of the inquiry were mounting up, and Starr still had to trap the President into committing a crime.
If my country asked me to set up a criminal investigation, the first thing I have to do is come up with the crime that has to be investigated. For it not to be a waste of the public's money, it was morally necessary that a crime be committed.
Starr argued that the President was shirking his legal duty by not leaving enough evidence. Desperately, he seized on the next piece of incriminating footage, supplied by an American camera crew who filmed Clinton after a jog for a fly-on-the-wall documentary about people who move their feet forward. The footage shows Clinton beckoning an intern to a side room. Out of context, it was dynamite. But in context, it was about as useless as a vicar. For White House security cameras show that the President merely wanted a second opinion on whether his milk was off.
You know, you want to check the data.
There's no lobster.
No, I would say that.
Shake it. It's good. It's a nice fluid feel.
My house daddy was a mean creamer. He guzzled him a whole cow each time.
My husband liked milk. He drank at least 8 pints a day, so he would often want a second opinion about his milk. Now, is that a criminal offence?
Is Dad a bust your ass machine?
Meanwhile, spooling back the original footage shows the President and his entourage innocently doing their daily 6-mile jog around the inside of the Oval Office.
What's the pen holder there, honey?
Starr was stuffed. Unless, what if, he probably was thinking. Linda Tripp is still the most hated woman in America. And I'm not exaggerating.
I've been nematized a whole sack of sick.
I've been called all sorts of things by the press.
Missy Flashy Flushy.
Toilet Mama Spice. Nixon. Mrs. Bastard. The British called me Dame Judas Stench.
Stench.
Well, you know, we'd all be in the office and the call would come through. There's a big item coming up. So there'd be this kind of, team spirit in the newsroom. And we'd all start singing silly songs like, here come the stories, itsy bitsy stories. Put them on, these are all our glories. You know the kind of thing.
Meanwhile, Kenneth Starr's investigation moved into first gear. His powers were all sucking. He could subpoena anyone he liked. The net was tightening round Bill Clinton as first his friends were called to testify, then his family, and finally on February the 19th, his dog. Inside the courtroom, Buster barked for 3 hours under intense cross-examination.
I done down in the ass and...
By this time, I was really low and started to pray at my local progressive synagogue, and I told Linda.
I go and rap at Linda's face.
And I rap back in her face.
So I said to her, who do you pray to? And she said, my Aunt Miriam and the mother of my friend Ellie.
My heartthrob Eli.
And I said, when did they die? And she told me, and I passed it on to Kenneth Starr, who hired a medium to subpoena the dead.
Straight to get a medium man to holler at the corpses.
Finally, on September the 14th, the President himself was called to testify before the grand jury. He agreed with Starr that his secret testimony could be put onto a videotape, filmed in front of a television camera, broadcast to the jury down a satellite feed, and given to a prosecution team out to get him. And therefore, he never expected it to leak out.
As I understood it was not, no.
Throughout the interrogation, the President came over rather well.
I don't remember
to whom I talked, when I talked to them, or what I said. I didn't remember the cherry chocolates. I don't remember that, sir. I don't remember when I said that. I don't remember that. I'm not denying it. I'm telling you what I remember and what I don't. I just don't remember. I just don't remember it. You asked me if I remembered. I don't. I don't remember. Oh, I do not remember. No, I do have a good memory.
Clinton admitted to an inappropriate relationship with Monica Lewinsky, but claimed what he and Lewinsky did together did not breach the carefully worded definition of sexual relations as agreed with the Jones lawyers.
A person engages in sexual relations when the person knowingly causes contact with the genitalia, breast, or buttocks of any person or attempts to squeeze, push, grind, parp, or bludgeon any bump with the desire to make the other person roar like an animal or mutually scoosh into or from the groinal field.
If Starr could determine that any scooshing actually happened between Clinton and Lewinsky, then he would have damning proof.
If the person being deposed kissed the breasts of another person...
Starr's lawyers continued to prod the president.
...of sexual relations as you understood it when you were under the oath in the Jones case?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
If a man were to attach strings to the nipples of a woman, cross them over, and attach the other end of the string to his own nipples, and then flip the woman over him so that together they made a cat's cradle, would that fall within the definition?
Yes, that would constitute contact. I think that would.
If I did this with my genitalia, this here.
I'm going to revert to my former statement.
And what about this? Or maybe this? Would this fall within the definition of sexual relations?
I will revert to my statement on that.
And now, Bob, if you would get out of your... If we were together, would that fall within the definition?
I will revert to my former statement.
Mr. President, could we adjourn now?
I had to pull out his sex guts.
I had to quiz him about his sexual activity because the legal point I was trying to make was that morally he was rotten to the core.
There was one mother of a pile of horse quit sitting in his stomach.
Starr, seen here cleaning gambling from his park, built up more evidence by granting witnesses immunity, though he didn't tell them the immunity didn't cover snitching on your friends, which he made a criminal offence and arrested them for. Meanwhile, when his video testimony was released, Clinton's poll ratings went up further. He was now more popular than the previous most popular thing ever. But then, disaster. The media had got hold of a videotape compiled by a camera team living in the Oval Office ceiling, making a fly-on-the-wall documentary about historic plaster. The tape was said to contain explicit scenes between Clinton and Lewinsky, and Starr ruled it should be broadcast, obviously.
Well, they did ask me to do one more report, but by that time, you know, the mental strain was such that I just felt I was in 1,000 pieces.
As a jumbo jet's autopilot goes haywire over London, could one of these be responsible?
Shortly after this broadcast, Gordon Brewer was taken outside by BBC officials and bollocked. Meanwhile, the tape was broadcast and the world stopped as armies and governments watched fascinated to see just how close the president came to Monica Lewinsky's ovaries.
I was hoping that...
The tape shows an affectionate, sometimes playful side to the relationship. Lewinsky asks the president if he wants some tea, and he insists he gets the milk.
I got some nice milk to show you.
A little later, as Lewinsky tries to get affectionate, he asks if they can just watch the bottle of milk together. She agrees. This continues for about an hour, until the security guard comes in.
Look at that.
The tape continued spewing out its graphic detail. At one point, it clearly shows the president using a ladder on Monica Lewinsky.
I burst the rumpy with...
Though I didn't have sexual relations with Monica Lewinsky, I did have sexual relations 6 feet away from her.
6 bounces from her skin.
But despite the hours of film, there was nothing Starr could find to incriminate the president. The footage showed a succession of playful, intimate moments between the two as they embraced, exchanged gifts, went chair racing, took it up the arse, and played boinging games. All seemed normal, but at the end of the tape, the following event occurs. Lewinsky is hopping for the president. At this point, the president receives a phone call. The White House records show it's a booking agency confirming his booking for two tickets to a Barbra Streisand concert. This is the moment scooshing occurs. Because of the explicit nature of this footage, we have censored the scooshed areas to allow for family viewing. This is what Starr was waiting for. To confirm the stain on the dress, he sent forensic scientists in to collect a pint of the president's semen. It was the evidence Starr needed, and soon his report was sent to Congress.
Ooh, I wouldn't like my kids reading that report, and it makes me feel bad.
Yes, so on reflection, with the fused head, I suppose there isn't that mental capacity to allow me to cope with the situation. So now I enjoy working with the puppets.
Initially, the report was criticised for what seemed like an obsessive description of Clinton and Lewinsky's sexual activities. In the report, Starr accused Clinton of obstructing justice by trying to hide gifts he'd received from Monica Lewinsky. These included 10 bottles of milk, which the president hid for 4 months under his bed.
Me so snug with my man parping like a cow that I
was so used to my husband coming to bed stinking of milk that I didn't think to look under the bed. But when I saw what was there, some of the milk was over 15 weeks old. The stench.
Puddle.
Looking on from across the Atlantic was Tony Blair, who now insisted his meetings with the president should include a cup of tea.
Whenever Tony had a cup of tea with the president, he would always try to drag it out. He'd say, this needs topping up with milk. I think he just wanted to get the milk close to the president's face. He'd say, Bill, would you like some cream?
He just wanted to see Bill Clinton pouring milk tight up upon his face.
Meanwhile, Starr was unloading more and more details of the case, while Clinton's defenders were scouring the footnotes for anything that might undermine it. They thought they came across something in an obscure footnote to the supplementary evidence saying, this report is based mostly on gossip. But Starr dismissed this, saying gossip was a Latin term meaning law. Meanwhile, Clinton's troubles grew worse as more evidence emerged, including this embarrassing footage of Clinton having a fight with Lewinsky's mother.
Well, the big boy says, get me your king, Mama.
He asked to see my mother, so I brought her in.
And
he said, how do you do, Mrs. Lewinsky? I'm Bill Clinton. And she said, hello, I now challenge you to a fight.
Give me a big skin rumble.
Mother!
The fight lasted for 50 minutes.
Master, Mr. President!
Sir, you need to... Mother!
Stand up like a woman and fight me, you bitch.
My, though I had gasless, rumpy balloons...
Though I did not have sexual relations with Monica Lewinsky in the Oval Office, I do admit I had her relations in the Oval Office.
I had her mama bits and her papa bits in that Oval Microsoft.
With the world seeing the most intimate details of the president's private life, it looked as if the forces of justice were moving in on him. Weren't it for the fact that he was now so popular his bar chart could be seen from space? While the president's ratings were so high, he remained safe. But Starr was not deterred. At the end of the last century, America was staring into the abyss. Years of impeachment procedures loomed ahead. Starr brought out a second report, concluding that since the population weren't shocked by the first one, they were obviously morally corrupt, and there were sufficient grounds to impeach the whole of America. For the next 4 years, he subpoenaed every state in alphabetical order, beginning with Alabama. He took particular delight quizzing women.
I was nice and honey-dovey with those pieces of skirt.
I was always really gentle with the ladies. Ladies are the holy glue from the Amazon. God made manifest his goodness in ladies.
Chief of police bust his ass pouring lovey stuff on them pieces of skirt.
But lo, he smote the man between the trousers.
The dude in the pants.
That's what it says in my Bible.
It's all there in my Jesus sandwich.
I was under a great deal of pressure. I had to convince the British public that I would not be involved in any of these sexual scandals. So that's when I decided to have this operation and become unisexual. That way, I mean, I didn't need any other sexual fulfillment other than myself. So it seemed to work out rather well.
In Tony Blair's 8-hour operation, the sex organs of himself and a female party worker were shuffled.
And it shows that we actually funded the NHS rather well, that I was able to have this operation.
The second Star report concluded that to even want to go into politics was a sign of dangerous arrogance. This conclusion was put to the test at the christening celebrations of Alfonso Dabieri in New York on January the 14th, 2002. At the christening, Alfonso's grandmother declared her hope that one day Alfonso might grow up to become president of the United States. A police officer immediately moved in and arrested the baby. America was at a political standstill until the president used his popularity to amend the Constitution, passing these clauses.
The Office of Independent Counsel shall simply go away. In the matter of sexual relations involving the people and a member of the executive performing outside the marital bond, oral sex is okay. We, the people, should loosen up. Perjury does not include lying when lying is the only sensible option available to get you out of trouble.
This last clause, allowing everyone to lie, solved the crisis at a stroke, but led to the collapse of Western civilization. From then on, nobody in power could be bothered discussing politics anymore and just did what the hell they liked. And so the century closed 3 decades ago with this happening, and with people not knowing if what they were saying was true.
Oh, the lies. Oh, the lies.
I am looking forward to the opportunity in the next few days of testifying.
And everybody was lying.
There's a great summer of sport on BBC television.
I'm innocent.
We had so many laughs about that. It was so funny. Because people could say whatever they wanted to, you know.
We had some good spirit. There's been a good feel around the boys.
This investigation has never been, quote, just about sex. It has been about telling the truth.
Monica is my close harmony heartthrob.
Monica was my closest friend. I wanted to protect her. If I hadn't taped our conversations, the Star report wouldn't have happened. America wouldn't have become more moral.
Clean like a cookie.
Crime would have gone up, and Monica might have got mugged or have someone do lousy work on her kitchen.
Fingers in her face, or do them bummy brothers put crap in a tap?
It is 2028. Claire Short is gradually donating her body to science. Robin Cook is still missing. In 2023, Antonia Blair resigned as Prime Minister in Britain's first ever masturbation scandal. Gordon Brewer won a BAFTA in 2004 for his children's programme Mr. Chumpy's Magic Pasties. William Hague was for 3 months ambassador to Nepal. So he could accuse Clinton of being guilty by association, Kenneth Starr impeached himself. Monica Lewinsky is now governor of the Federal Panopticon, the sophisticated monitoring headquarters that houses the living burial of Linda Tripp 400 feet below the ground. Tripp was placed there in 2006 for all the trouble she'd caused and now roams its network of tunnels and games rooms on her own. She is a CB radio enthusiast and is actually quite happy. Hillary Clinton is still married to Bill Clinton, who's found religion and become a Mormon. He now has 7 wives who are all standing by him in the White House. Clinton's high opinion poll ratings have allowed him to overturn the results of every presidential election since 2002. David Meller's son runs a small business making training videos for learner coach drivers. He keeps pipe tobacco.
The Bickian Billy Connolly is up for a one-night stand on BBC One in 15 minutes. Big hair, big comedy.